Good evening, everybody. Please turn the Word of God to Luke chapter 5 in your Bible. Luke chapter 5, and it's wonderful to be here at the Liberty Baptist Church. Luke chapter 5 in the Word of God, and we'll stand together and read Luke chapter 5 in your Bible. If you love Jesus, say amen.
Amen.
I'm not going to preach long. I'll get out of the way so Brother Tony can get up here and preach, my hillbilly friend, and bring him up here. I know some of you had a long day working and all that you have going on, but it is good to be here tonight, and wonderful to see all of you, and I appreciate the members of this church. I appreciate your faithfulness to the Lord. I appreciate the Lord for what He's done here and in this place, and it never ceases to amaze me, the goodness of God in our lives. Let's pray. Father, I pray you give us something from the Word right now. I pray it would be helpful. I pray it would be profitable. I pray you put your spirit in this place in a very real way. Please get the glory. I pray in Jesus' precious and holy and wonderful name. Amen. Luke chapter 5, and it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were going out of them and were washing their nets, and he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now, when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night, and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees and saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. And you can be seated. I love this story in the Word of God. I want you to just notice it and follow along here with me. And here we see the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me remind you, you know, Jesus really did live.
Amen.
This isn't a made-up story. I had the privilege of going to Israel twice. There was a guy in our church who had a lot of money, and he sent a whole family to go. And it was great to go there, and I got to be on what's called the Sea of Galilee. And it's really there, and Christ really lived, and Christ really did exist. The Bible is the Word of God, and so we know this to be true in this story here. And it's an amazing story if you can envision, if you can imagine. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the Word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. So he's there, and he's right up there to the shoreline. And God goes on, the Lord Jesus Christ goes on to do this amazing miracle. He stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake. So he's there, and the two ships are there. The fishermen were going out of them and were washing their nets. So they had fished all night long, and they were just not the kind of fishing where you go for pleasure. We used to live in Texas. My dad was principal for the Rebecca Christian School. And what it was a ministry for people that had addictions issues, people that were court ordered there. And we lived there, and then they had a place called the Lighthouse. And it was for the men. It was 40 miles out away from the shore on the Intercoastal Canal, and they would fish all night long. Now, sometimes, oh man, I love to go fishing, but when you're working and fishing, it's a whole different story.
Right.
And these guys would fish all night. You had to stay up all night long, which is not easy, and they'd fish all night and pull in the nets. And so these men here, professional fishermen, and they go and they're cleaning their nets, they're washing their nets, and here's Jesus, and he's pressed up to the shoreline. The people are pressing upon him, and he says to them, hey, I want you to go out, and you're going to fish some more. And they're like, oh, my goodness, you know, we have already cleaned things up. Peter said, after the Lord told him to go and start this fishing again, the Lord said, at thy word, I will let down the net. So Peter was going to obey, and I'm just fast-tracking through this story. And here we go and see Peter and the disciples, and they go out to fish again. Notice verse 6, and when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. Now, if you can imagine catching no fish, and then all of a sudden, you've got so many fish that it's breaking the nets, I mean, that would have been a mind-boggling experience. And they beckoned unto their partners. So they're calling over the other guys, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships so that it began to sink. Now, can you imagine the weight of those fish that they're pressing these boats that far down into the water? And the ships were about to sink in the water. And when Simon Peter saw it, verse 8, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." And then I want you to notice, and this is my whole message, I just want you to notice very simple tonight, verse 9. For he was, what's that next word?
Astonished.
Everybody help me. For he was what?
Astonished.
Would you mark that in your Bible, if it's your habit to mark or underline in your Bible? For he was astonished. And here it is, when Peter saw what had happened here, this miracle that the Lord did, the Bible says he was astonished. Now notice also in verse 9, and all that were with him. So everybody there, they were all astonished. Verse 10 in particular says, and so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And these were professional fishermen. And so here, when the Lord did this miracle and filled up their nets to the point of the nets breaking and the ships almost sinking, here was their reaction to the miracle that Christ did. They were astonished. They were astonished. God blew their mind.
Yeah.
They were amazed about what Jesus Christ had done right there, live and in person, in front of them. They could not believe what they were experiencing. And again, this is not a made-up story. This really did happen. They fished all night, no fish in the net. Christ is there, and here, the nets break with the amount of fish. And the result was, they were astonished. And again, that's the key word. They were astonished. Now, when you really think about what happened here in the story, no wonder they were astonished. But when you really think about in your life and what my life's God has done, we ought to be astonished by the work of God in our life. Let me ask you a question. When was the last time you were astonished by God? When was the last time, think with me, when you really thought about God, when you really concentrated on God's involvement in your life, and it astonished you? When's the last time you were amazed by God? When's the last time you were surprised by God? When was the last time you were awestruck by God? Thunderstruck by God? When's the last time you thought about how unbelievably good and how awesome God is and has been in your life, and it brought you to this moment of, I can hardly believe what I'm experiencing right now. I can hardly believe what it is that God has done for me in my life. Listen to me. It's too easy. It's too easy to get used to God. It's too easy to get over God. It's too easy almost to come to a point of complacency when we think about God. That's not the way that it should be. Brother Burton talked about being saved 14 years. And I remember when I got saved, I'm 49, I got saved at 8 years old. I've been saved 41 years. You take his 14 and flip it, and that's me. 41 years I've been saved. And I want you to hear me. I've been around Christianity a long time, and there are a lot of people that get over God. That should not happen. That should not happen. There are a lot of people that get astonished by things that really shouldn't blow their mind. Things that they get amazed by. Oh, Tom Brady, the Super Bowl, and, you know, greatest of all time. And boy, the comeback. And I'm all for football. I'm not against football. But let me just say something. That's not really so astonishing. It's throwing a football. Are y'all with me? That's not mind-boggling. Tomorrow morning before we go out and have soul winning bus visitation, I play football on Saturday morning. And we get up early, we play, we meet out there, and I can throw a football. Now, I'm not Tom Brady, that's for sure. But here would be the point. It's a football. I can duplicate what it is that he's able to do. I can throw that football. Now, not at that level, y'all tracking me. But what I'm saying is this. What he's doing is not supernatural. What he's doing is not so amazing. What he's doing is not so astonishing. Technology. Oh, do you know what my iPhone can do? Come on. Oh, do you know? And we can, oh, man, you ought to see. And people go and have their technology. And, man, I can do this and I can do it. And my phone. And, wow. Young people will play a video game. Oh, man, the graphics. It's unbelievable. It's just like it's real. It's not real, dummy. It's a video game that people get so excited about. People get their minds blown. People act so excited. They get all astonished about some sports event. Are you with me? Or about some automobile. Philadelphia Auto Show. Just had, wow, this car, man, the door opens up instead of out. So what? It's still a door. But people get so excited about things. They get so overwhelmed by things. They get so amazed by things that really aren't that special. But let me just tell you something. In this story, when Peter and Andrew and James and John and those disciples were there, and they go out there and on that Sea of Galilee after having fished all night, and here it was in daytime, not the time you'd normally fish. Are you with me? No, they did night fishing, and that's when they knew the time. These were professional guys. This was the wrong time of day. After it had already been a dead night of fishing. And here it is, those nets dropped down. Peter said, I'll let down the net. As far as we know, we had put one down. And he goes and he lets that net down there. And let me just tell you, it must have been the most awesome thing to see more fish than they had ever seen in their life at one time. Fill up that net to the point the weight of it was so great, the nets were breaking. And they're calling for their friends and they're pulling over their ship. And both ships, I mean, the fish just kept coming and coming and coming. Listen, only Christ could do what happened that day. And that filled up both ships, and the ships are sinking down. And they're like, boys, we're going to sink these puppies. Stop bringing the fish on. And the natural spiritual reaction Peter had, and all that were with him, and James and John, the Bible says they were astonished. Astonished. Here's what I'm suggesting this evening. It's time for you as a Christian to get more astonished about your God. Yeah, it's time for me and you both to get our amazement about God back in our life. It's time that we get more surprised by and even shocked by. I cannot believe the greatness of my God. It's time for us to be overwhelmed by God in our lives. Here's what I'm saying. The things of God should excite you. The things of God should be astonishing to you. So the message is very simple. Two words. Stay astonished. Stay astonished. Don't get over God. Don't come to the point where you're not amazed, why you're not overwhelmed, where you're not just having your mind blown by the things of God. Quickly, number one. Be astonished and stay astonished by the word of God that he's given you. Look if you would in verse 1. It came to pass as the people pressed upon him. Why were they pressing upon Christ? To hear the word of God. Now, let me just tell you, there's no preacher like the Lord Jesus Christ. What are we going to do when we get to heaven? If we're there for all of eternity, what are we going to do? I'll tell you one thing we'll probably do the first 10 million years. We'll let Jesus just preach the word of God for us. And we're going to see things we never saw, hear things we never heard. There's no preaching like his preaching. There's no teaching like his teaching. And so here it is. Listen, they're pressing upon him. I mean, the crowd was so great, they were pushing him into the water. My soul, may God help us in Philadelphia to see a revival where people are pressing to hear the word of God. And here it was, that people pressed upon him. But why was it? It was to hear the word of God. Y'all been in a crowd. I go to an Eagles game, go to a Sixers. Well, the Sixers actually have people coming now. But you go to, you get one of those crowds, and you start, y'all know how when the stadium empties out. And what's, y'all, have you ever been to a Sixers game or an Eagles game where it was crowded, Flyers game? Expensive stuff, isn't it? Anymore on my soul. But anyway, off the subject, but on the subject. Somebody, I've got you depressed because I'm talking about the Eagles. But here's the thought. Go Raiders? No. So here it is. You get pressed. You get pressed in that crowd. And they're being pressed, and they're pressing forward to Christ. They're pushing him right into the water to the point where he had to get in that ship. But their purpose in pressing towards the Lord was to hear the word of God. Notice it. He stood by the lake of Gennesaret, saw two ships standing by the lake. The fishermen were gone out, and here it is. He sat down, verse 3, notice, and taught the people out of the ship. So the people are pressing upon him, and it's to hear the word of God. Let me remind you tonight, and I don't want you to get over it. You need to stay astonished. There's no book like the Bible. The Bible is the word of God. God has given us, in this King James Bible, the inspired, perfectly preserved word of God without mistake or error. There's not one mistake in this book. This book is the living word of God. These words on the words of God page will speak to you. They will change your life. The more you get into the Bible, the more the Bible will get into you. And you're old enough to read the Bible. How old are you? Nine, you know. Listen, I read my Bible through the first time when I was 11 years old. You younger ones that are getting grown up very quick, and that's not just to pat me on the back. I was challenged to read the Word of God. But you're old enough, and you read the Word of God. And if you don't know how to read, you can go and get somebody to get you a CD of it or something. But the Word of God is something that is amazing. Yeah. See, if I started right now, and I gave a sentence to you, and you whispered in her ear, and you whispered in her ear, and we went around, and we got all the way, by the time we got to Brother Tony, it would be something completely different.
Right.
Y'all with me? Because if it was up to us to keep something straight, we'd mess it up.
Yes.
Are you with me? Well, let me just tell you, when God said that He would preserve His Word for us, He has the power to keep it. And there's not one mistake, there's not one error. You can put your total confidence in the Word of God. And it ought to astonish you that God has shown you the truth of the Bible. Last week, Brother Tony and I were in California at Brother Doug Fisher's church, and we both had privilege of preaching in that church. And I left there to the service, and I was driving up the road, and I saw a couple of Mormon boys. And they had the white shirts on, the tie, their little tag. And I ended up turning around, and I went to speak to them, give them a gospel tract. And you know what they did? They wanted me. I said, I'll trade you here. If you'll take mine, I'll take yours. And they took the gospel tract, but they gave me the Book of Mormon. Now, if you don't know much of the history of it, I don't want to get bogged down. There was a man named Joseph Smith, and he came up with the Book of Mormon. And they put the Book of Mormon on the same level as the Word of God. And he gave me a copy of the Book of Mormon. He opened it up to a certain chapter in one of the names of their book. And it was chapter 7 of a certain thing in there. And he wanted me to read it. I said, you want me to read the whole chapter? He said, yes, we believe that this will build faith in your heart. It's so sad. Same principles we believe about the Word of God. That if we get the Word of God in somebody's life, it'll help to grow faith. He's trying to grow faith in my heart for Joseph Smith's writings in the Book of Mormon. Joseph Smith, if you study his life, he was a crackpot.
Right.
He was a crazy man. But listen, there are millions of people that believe in Mormonism. If you go to Center City, right off the Vine Street Expressway in the middle of town right now, look up the most lit up building. It looks like the Disney Castle. That's the newest building right there on that stretch, and it's the Mormon Temple. And if you look up on top, there's this gold dude looking thing, and that's the prophet Moroni. Supposedly, this guy that gave golden tablets to Joseph Smith while he was in New York, and all of a sudden they put these on the same level of the Word of God. Let me just tell you something. It is sad, so sad that those people are deceived by a lie and believing that falsehood about the Book of Mormon. And if you're here tonight and you know what this book is, it is the grace of God in your life. You know better than anybody else. You couldn't be following the Quran. You couldn't be following the Book of Mormon. But thank God you're following God's book, the scriptures. And when Jesus was there, He was preaching and teaching the Word of God. Aren't you glad for the day when God showed you the truth of the Word of God? And we need to stay astonished about the Bible. We need to stay astonished about the things that God shows us in the Scriptures. It's amazing. Because of time, I want to get out of the way. But the Bible says this, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. You understand the book you hold in your hand is a living book. God breathed out, God spoke out the words of God, and we have them tonight. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. God gave it by inspiration. God kept it by preservation. The words of the Lord are pure words. God's kept His book. So we ought to be people who stay astonished by the Word of God that He's given you. Number two, quickly. You ought to be astonished and stay astonished by the mercy of God that He's had on you. Look at verse 9, if you would. Pick it up in verse 8. Here's Peter. Peter was a roughneck fisherman. And here he was in verse 8. They beckon unto their partners. The ships are sinking. Verse 8, here's Peter's reaction. When Simon Peter saw it. Saw what? All those fish, net breaking, ship sinking. When he saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, help me church, what's he said? Depart from me, why? For I am a sinful man, O Lord. Listen, Peter knew he didn't deserve to have Jesus in his boat. And I want you to hear me tonight. I don't deserve to have Jesus in my boat. You don't deserve to have Jesus in your boat. And Peter said, listen, I can't believe that I have this one that could do that miracle here and with me right now. He said, depart from me. It wasn't because he loved Jesus, but he was overwhelmed that he, as a sinner, would have the Son of God right there and interacting in his life. And it ought to be something that continues to astonish you. That you and I, as people that ought to split hell wide open, we're not going to hell. Listen, I remember when my dad and mom weren't saved. And my mom was a typical South Jersey girl, and she lived here in Philly at times, Germantown, went to Little Flower High School for a year of her high school years, Catholic girl, I mean, bought in completely. My great-grandfather would have been a janitor for one of the Catholic schools here in Philly, and grew up with all of that. My mom, she loved the old-school Latin Mass, and followed all the way with Catholicism, and I was growing up, my mom and dad were unsaved. My dad was a typical Jersey construction worker, had his drywall business, and he'd go over the Cherry Hill racetrack and play the horses, and he would play poker, and he did his thing, and out there hunting and trying to raise us kids. And my mom and dad, listen, they were headed towards hell. And I want to thank God that God worked in our family and saved my dad and saved my mom and allowed me to be saved as a young boy. Listen, it's the grace of God when any of us get saved. Brother Burton said tonight, we don't need to get that struck. That's the truth. We need to make sure we don't get over our salvation. And he said, thank God, his little girls, they won't know and they've not experienced all of what he lived. But let me just tell you something. All of you that did get saved while you're young, I decided a long time ago, I'm very thankful for the drunk that gets saved, for the drug addict that gets saved, for the person that gets saved out of all that mess. But I don't want to let them outshout me, out-astonish me, because God kept me from so much of that mess that's out there on the street. Are y'all with me? I'm not putting anybody down, but for sure, if anybody ought to be astonished, it ought to be me, that I get to live the life I've lived. But I don't care whether you get saved at young, at 41, or 14. Listen, I remember Brother Burke when he was just first saved. Pastor, Reverend Doctor, most holy potentate, I'm only kidding, messing around. I remember, listen, I was in a meeting with some other men, and Brother Burke was going to go to Bible college. He probably would say maybe a year, maybe something like that, year, 2 years, something like that. And we were sitting there, and they were going to have a story of a guy that was going to go to Bible college. And he came in, he was raw. Man, he came walking in, and he was like, bless God. I mean, he didn't know what he was saying, what he was doing. He's telling us how he got saved. He had just been barely saved. Let me just tell you something. It was amazing then, 14 years ago. It's amazing now. The day that he's not astonished by his salvation anymore is the day that he's in trouble. Come on now. And I want to make sure that I stay astonished, Brother Tony, stay astonished by the mercy of God in my life. And I know the mercy of God. God's been real to me. God's been good. And here Peter, he looked at that and said, man, I can't believe Christ is so close to me. Stay astonished by the mercy of God that he's had on your life. Number three, quickly. Stay astonished by the power of God that he's shown you. By the power of God that he's shown you. Pick it up in verse 4. You see this. When he left speaking, he says, launch out into the deep. They do it. Master, we toiled all the night, taking nothing but at thy word. Here it is. We'll let down the net. They enclosed a great multitude. Notice that. A great multitude of fishes and their net break. You know what they were saying? They were seeing the power of Christ right there.
Yeah.
And here it was. They were amazed by, they were astonished by, seeing and experiencing the power of God. Now, I remind you tonight, there's no one like God. Y'all tracking? Here's what I'm saying. We need to get overwhelmed by God. We need to get amazed by God. We need to be astonished by God. He's the I am. When he spoke to Moses, he said, I am. Not, listen, not I was like a has been. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's immutable. That means he's incapable of change. He's a constant. He's the rock that we build our lives upon. He's the way, the truth, the life. He's the door. He's the good shepherd of the sheep. He's got all love. He's got all power. He's got all might. He has all strength. He knows all things. He's everywhere. Listen, there's no one like our God. He's holy, 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 thrice holy God. Not any stain, not any spot in our God. There's no one like our God. And he knows where you're at, and he's working in your life, and it's great to know the power of God. Providentially, God has worked in my life. my life. Providence is the hand of God at work in your life. And when you think about the fact that God's interacting in your situations, the fact that He knows where you live. Are you with me? And He does. He knows where you live. He knows what your problems are. He knows what's going on. He's glad you're here tonight. And here's what I'm saying. Listen, hey, we serve a powerful God. And it ought to astonish us that God would work in our lives the way that He does. He's a creator of the universe. And it's an amazing thing. Think about the way that He answers your prayers. How many are glad that God answers prayers? Say amen. You know what that is? That's the power of God. I mean, you see God working providentially, and you see God answering your prayers, and you see God helping you with your problems. And listen, how about when you feel His presence? Don't you love to feel God? I just love to feel God. You say, oh, Todd, that's a little bit weird. What do you mean by that? I'm talking about in my heart. We don't worship God just in truth, although I don't want to go over the truth. There's no truth like God's truth. But we worship in spirit. That means this. Listen, our spirit is our born-again heart. I'm glad I'm not saved by feeling, but it does feel good. Are you with me? Oh, brother, you got to go out there and get a high. There's no high like knowing you're saved and feeling the power and presence of God. There's no substitute for the presence of God. You know what's cool? It can be just you and God in your car. You with me? It can be just you and God in your car. I had a song tonight. I was getting ready, and that's one of the reasons I was late. I was enjoying a song, and it was... Are you with me? You ever just enjoy a song? Y'all know what I'm talking about. And I was about to have my head pop off. I was just getting into it. Come on. Now, people in the world do that. They go to some rock concert, some rap concert. Are you with me? They all go crazy and act like a bunch of wild people over a bunch of heathen stuff. I'm glad God touches my heart in a more real way. And listen, I don't need to go out and do something that's going to make me feel guilty. Come on. I go to bed tonight, put my head on my pillow, and feel good about the fact that I felt good in church. And we need to make sure that we don't become deadhead Christians. Come on. Dead, dry, dusty. Come on. Now, people go to the ball game about tearing the stadium apart. You go to church, get a little excited. People, what's wrong with him? Hey, it shouldn't be what's wrong with him. It's what's right with him or what's right with her. Come on now. Those songs that you get to sing. I didn't say you have to sing. I said you get to sing. We get to sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I'm the wretch in that song. And so are you. We ought to split hell wide open. The power of God is real. Come on. It's real stuff. And we need to make sure that we stay astonished by the fact that God has power and God is interacting. And when we get to praise Him and feel His presence, and He's helping me with my problems, and He's answering my prayers, and He's providentially interacting in my life, I get to know that God is real. Oh, what a Savior is mine. And I'm going to stay astonished about the power of God in my life.
Yeah.
Oh, well, you know, fill up the net. Yeah, well, we're sinking the boats right now. Well, fellas, I guess, no, y'all understand, they were professional fishermen. They had never one time in their life had a catch like this.
Right.
That was just amazing. And they didn't get over it. They stayed astonished.
Yes.
Lastly, quickly, we need to stay astonished by the plan of God that He has for you. By the plan of God that He has for you. So here's old Peter. He knew it was the mercy of God because he was a reprobate commercial fisherman and God saved his life. And he knew that it was a miracle. He had seen the power of God and they were all there hearing the word of God. There was no preaching and teaching like Christ's teaching. But here's what's really amazing. Notice this in verse 10. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners of Simon. And Jesus, can you imagine, after all this goes down the way that it did, and Jesus said unto Simon, fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men.
Yeah.
Now, Peter is listening to this, and he had already said, Lord, depart from me. I'm not even worthy to have you here in the boat. But Jesus just takes it up a notch. You know, that's what the Lord does in our life.
Amen.
Not only does He show us His power and give us His word and have mercy on our souls, but then He puts this plan in Peter's life. He says, Peter, listen, hey, you're going to go ahead and you're going to catch men. And you know what that meant? He was going to get to be with Jesus in the work that Christ had. And when they had brought their ships to land, amazing statement, they forsook all.
Yeah.
They forsook all those fish. Come on now. Yeah. If you were caught fish for a living and you had the biggest catch ever and you finally get all those fish to the shore, listen, they forsook all. They left the fish on the beach. I don't know who discovered them and really got excited. But they go and they left the fish there. Hey, listen, they even left the ships there. That's what the Bible says. They forsook all. Talk to me, church. And what did they do? The last three words. And followed him. You know what they got to be? Christ followers. You know what we are? Christians. We get to be Christ-like. We get to be disciples. I said we get to be. Nobody makes us come to church tonight. We get to come to church tonight. We get to live for Jesus Christ. We get to be ambassadors for Christ. I don't want to ever get over the fact that God said, listen, not only am I going to save you, Clark, and pull you out of your mess, although you deserve hell, and not only am I going to show you the power of God that's real and in your life, not only am I going to give you a copy of the Word of God, but I'm going to let you follow me. I'm going to let you leave your stupid things that don't really matter and be part of the greatest organization on earth, Christ's local church. And Christ said, I will build my church and you can help. Think about that. Hey, I get to help in the work of God. What a miracle. I'm a dirty rotten sinner. I ought to go to hell. And instead, I get to help build a church. What a privilege. What a privilege that they had this plan. And I'm telling you right now, God has a plan for your life that's bigger than anything you can imagine. It's bigger than anything this world could ever offer you. You get to be part of the work of God. My dad started our church 36 years ago. And we went and found, my dad found a little Methodist church building. And we went in there and started that church. I remember our first service, I kept track. We had 63 people. I was 13 years old. The next week, we had a whole lot less. There were, you know, your friends come and everybody comes. And man, we started getting people to come to that church. I remember my dad on the midweek prayer meeting service, he put up one of those white dry erase boards. And at a certain point, I remember him writing the number 50 on there, Brother Tony. Right? Dad was trying to, wanted us to see that we were going to get some more people, Brother Bert. He wrote 50 on there. And that was our goal, to try to have 50 people in church. And we were in that little Methodist church building, the auditorium, probably, man, I don't know. But anyway, we had a goal. We wanted to get more people in. And God started saving souls. Amen. Oh, it was a miracle, man. We had people come that not everybody, you know, in our church, we had a lot of bikers coming back then. And we had these guys that got saved. Hey, the bikes would pull up and the Harleys would be parked out front. Man, they come revving up there, you know. And it was different. I'm not going to lie. But God was saving souls and God was changing lives. And you attract what you are. My dad was only 37 years old at that time. And he had only been saved about 7 years. You can imagine. My dad was a rough guy. And he'd just get up in the pulpit and tell it like it was. But let me tell you something. In South Jersey, the people just liked hearing shoot there. And they hear the word of God and people came. And God built our church. Are you with me? And all these years, by God's grace, I've gotten to be part of it. Now 27 and a half years, full time, I've had the opportunity to work at the church. And God's given us a big building. And God's done a lot of wonderful things. And I'm telling you, it's the greatest life lived when you get to live for the Lord. I think about this place here. I remember we met here with the former pastor, and this place, nothing. Are you listening? Nothing was going on here. That's not ripping on him, just wasn't anything going on. I remember when Brother Burton first came to Philly, Brian Green with you, they showed up here. I remember the first time I took you to meet Pastor Penichetti and went over there, and listen, and God worked in that situation, and we got to come to this building, and there was a cleanup going on, and all that happened, and now look at it, it's unbelievable. Are you listening? Brother Burton, you stay astonished about what God's done in this building. I'm talking about the physical location. Come on. I remember first coming and thinking, this is unbelievable. Walked over the other one, three stories, the house next door. Here was going on, and it was going to come open. Come on now. See, God looked down from heaven and said, there's a place in Philly that needs an independent Bible-believing Baptist church. And God marked out this corner. Come on now. God marked out this corner. And God did that for this man and for all of you here. Brother Cordo, I remember y'all over there in Pensauken and reaching into Pensauken camp and getting that girl ready for where she was going to be. And the Lord did that. The Lord did that. And being in that BMW hall in those tough days and those teenage girls and out there working that van route and being in that nurse. I remember being there. Come on. That's Providence. Yeah, Jay Harder waving at me and where he's from and what God's done and being in our Christian school and riding the speed line every day and God getting him ready. Brother Paul, you and Candy come the first time, her eyes were this big. She was scared to death. I was making jokes. She was not joking. And she was scared to death about being over here coming from Illinois. Are you listening? I'm saying that was the work of God. God gave Brother Tony first time going to New Manna, and me telling the lady at the Hampton Inn, I'm preaching at New Manna. Her just... Come on, the testimony in town was not a good thing. But God changed the testimony of the church there. Some of you know what I'm talking about, some of you don't. But I'm saying this, listen, hey, it's the grace of God, it's the goodness of God, it's the providential hand of God, that God would have a plan for Knucklehead Charles Clark III, and God's got a plan for you. It's not just for me as a preacher, it's for every lady in this room, it's for every man in this room, it's for every teenager here in the room. It's the God of heaven that has a plan for us, and it ought to blow our mind, and we ought to get in on it. Man, I'm telling you, run the buses, do what you still call a super church or whatever you call it. Super church, come on now. Hey, listen, that's all good stuff. And if you get to go and knock on a door or hand out a gospel tract, or you get to work in the nursery or stand here and sing a song, or get to work in the sound booth, are you listening? It's all God's wonderful grace in your life, God's mercy in your life. Don't get over it. Stay astonished. Remember Paul? Paul had the Lord speak to him on the Damascus Road. The Bible says there that he was astonished. The natural result of being astonished by God is sacrificial Christ following. When you're really astonished by God, you're going to say, I'm going to follow Jesus.
That's right.
Are you with me? I mean, when you get touched, you're not going to want him to get away. You're going to want to be following Christ. And when, I'm telling you, listen, hey, it knocked Paul to his knees. It knocked Peter to his knees right there in the boat. All those fish, and here he is. He's on his knees. Are you with me? He's on the knees, the fish there smelling. Some of you heard Brother Fisher preaching that at the summit. Listen, hey, he was there, and he's in front of Christ, and he's with those smelly fish. They're about up to his ears, and he says, depart from me. Listen, but he did not want to not serve God, and God allowed him to follow him. Stay astonished about the Word of God that He gave you. Stay astonished about the mercy that He's had on you. Stay astonished about the power of God that He's shown you. Stay astonished about the plan of God that He has for you. Listen, I don't have to preach tonight. I get to preach. I don't get to sing this. I don't have to sing the song. I get to sing the song. And here it is. Too many people, they just get it over. Just, well, you know, hey. Brother Tony, get to come up here and preach to Brother Burton. Just an opportunity. Manor Racing Clan, get to come. You get to sing. Mike McKenzie here tonight. BBC people, get to come. Liberty Baptist people, listen. You get to be here another service. It's a grace of God. Listen, you're sitting here. Some of you sitting here with your spouse, little kids here. Unbelievable. Amazing, isn't it? Just amazing. Isn't it amazing? I went longer than I should have, and I hope it's not too long. Father, I pray that you would help us to stay astonished. Oh, dear Lord God, you blow our minds. Lord, it's amazing. It's amazing. Lord, we're so thankful tonight. Help us, God, please. Get the glory, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name.
Now it's going to begin to play. Maybe I'll come thank the Lord for being